From a sore throat to the sniffles to a cough, everyone feels sick sometimes. But what is it that causes us to experience these symptoms? The answer is pathogens. A pathogen can be described as any microorganism that causes disease. What is a microorganism? Let's break down the word. Micro means extremely small, too small to be seen with the naked eye, and organism means living thing. So, microorganisms are microscopic living things. Here's where it gets a little tricky. Not all pathogens are microscopic, and not all are living. As a general rule of thumb, you can think of pathogens as really small things that can make you sick. Sometimes you may hear microorganisms referred to as germs. The important thing to remember is that not all microorganisms cause disease, but pathogens do. Generally, pathogens come in four different types: viruses, bacteria, fungi, and parasites. In this video, we'll describe each type of pathogen and talk about what separates these groups, how these organisms cause disease, and show some common examples. Viruses. Let's first take a look at viruses. Viruses are unique in that, technically speaking, they are not alive. This makes them different from all the other pathogen types. Viruses are made of two parts: a DNA molecule and a protein coat that surrounds it. In order to reproduce, viruses invade the cells of other organisms. These cells are then called host cells. Once a virus invades, it will use the resources available inside the host cell to replicate itself, creating more viruses. When these resources are exhausted, the host cell bursts, releasing the new copies of the virus into the body. This process of viral infection, replication, and spread inside the body is what causes us to feel sick. Luckily, some viruses can be treated with the use of antiviral medications. Antiviral medications work by blocking viruses from invading healthy host cells. Because they can't enter the host cell, the virus can no longer reproduce. This gives the body's immune system time to clean up any viruses that remain in the body. In order for most antiviral medications to be effective, they have to be taken before or in the early stages of illness. Unfortunately, not all viruses can be treated with antiviral medication. There are many diseases caused by viruses. Some well-known examples are the influenza virus that causes the flu, the Lyssa virus that causes rabies, human immunodeficiency virus that causes HIV, the adenovirus that causes bronchitis, and the Ebola virus that causes Ebola. Bacteria. Next, let's examine bacteria. Bacteria are living, single-celled microorganisms, which are much larger than viruses. Bacteria occur in three main shapes: cocci, which means spherical; vibrio, which means coiled; and bacilli, which means rod-shaped. One important thing to remember about bacteria is that not all bacteria are pathogenic. This means that not all types of bacteria make us sick. In fact, there are many species of bacteria that are beneficial to humans, like the ones that live in our digestive tract and the ones present in food products like cheese and yogurt. When pathogenic bacteria enters the body, it begins reproducing and releasing harmful toxins. These toxins damage body tissues and interrupt normal body functions. As the number of bacteria and their toxins build up, we start feeling ill. Common examples of bacterial infections are strep throat, food poisoning, Lyme disease, whooping cough, and ear infections. Illnesses caused by bacteria can usually be treated through the use of medications called antibiotics. Antibiotics kill the bacteria present in the body and allow the body's immune system to begin clearing the remaining toxins from the tissues. Not all antibiotics work across all bacteria, so doctors make sure to prescribe an antibiotic that will target the specific bacteria causing their patients' illnesses. Fungi. Fungi are another type of pathogen. While some types of fungi are macroscopic, you can see them with the naked eye, the spores produced by fungi are microscopic. Fungal spores are individual cells of the fungus which are used for reproduction. Types of fungi include mushrooms, molds, and yeast. Now, not all species of fungi are pathogenic, but of those that are, most cause rashes, irritation, or infection when their spores are inhaled. A fungal infection is called mycosis. This can occur from direct contact with a fungus in the environment, or the fungus could grow directly on the skin. Fungi love to live in warm, wet environments, so sweaty areas like armpits and feet are most susceptible to fungal infections. Fungus can also be found in the soil. When soil contains pathogenic fungi, people can become ill when they are exposed to the fungal spores. These spores can enter the body through cuts in the skin or from inhaling small particles of dirt. Soil can be contaminated with fungi through animal feces. One common example of this is the histoplasma fungus, which is found in soil that contains large amounts of either bird or bat poop. Some examples of fungal infections are athlete's foot, dandruff, ringworm, and thrush. Fungal infections can be treated with antifungal creams or medications which prevent the fungus from producing spores, kills the fungus, and stops the infection. Parasites. Finally, let's look at the last type of pathogen, parasites. Parasites are organisms that live in or on other organisms at the host organism's expense. These organisms are very diverse, so scientists have organized them into three main types: protozoa, worms, and ectoparasites. Like fungi, parasites can be microscopic or macroscopic. Protozoa are the smallest class of parasite, as they are all single-celled organisms. When they enter the body, they begin to steal nutrients from cells. As the parasites replicate and consume more of the body's nutrients, this can cause people to feel sick. Protozoa can be passed via human contact or from ingesting contaminated food and water. Protozoa may be small, but they can have a huge impact on the body. Perhaps the most well-known disease caused by protozoa is malaria. Specifically, malaria is caused by the protozoan Plasmodium falciparum, which causes people to feel intense flu-like symptoms when infected. Other examples of protozoa and the diseases they cause are Balanitidium coli, which causes balanitidiasis, Toxoplasma gondii, which causes toxoplasmosis, and Entamoeba histolytica, which causes amoebiasis. Worms, also known as helminths, are another class of parasite. These pathogenic worms include tapeworms, roundworms, and flukes, all of which cause disease in humans. When these worms, or their eggs, enter the body from contaminated food, water, or soil, they invade specific body tissues and steal nutrients. In humans, parasitic worms most often infect organs of the digestive tract. When roundworms enter the body, they can cause a disease called ascariasis, which causes fatigue and abdominal discomfort. Similarly, tapeworms can cause a sickness known as teniasis, which has similar symptoms. Other parasitic worms are Ankylostoma duodenale, which is a type of hookworm that causes ankylostomiasis, and Schistosoma flukes that cause schistosomiasis. The last form of parasites are ectoparasites. The prefix ecto means outside, so ectoparasites are those that live on the outside of their host organism. For example, on their skin or in their hair or fur. Ectoparasites often bite or burrow in the skin of their host organism in order to take nutrients from the host. Ectoparasites themselves often carry pathogenic bacteria that is transmitted to humans through their bites. Sometimes, one ectoparasite is capable of carrying multiple potential diseases. Perhaps the most well-known ectoparasite is ticks, which can cause diseases such as Lyme disease and encephalitis. Phew! Who knew there were so many microorganisms out there that are capable of causing illnesses? Let's take a moment and review. In this video, we learned that pathogens are considered any microorganism that causes disease. There are four types of pathogens: viruses, bacteria, fungi, and parasites. Most of these organisms are microscopic, meaning they are so small they cannot be seen with our eyes. However, a small amount of them are large enough to be seen, like some of the helminths and ectoparasites we discussed. Pathogens can also be single-cellular or multicellular, meaning made of one cell or many cells. Overall, it is clear to see that pathogens are a very diverse group of organisms. Even though there are tons of pathogens lurking out there, there are many things we can do to prevent ourselves from getting ill. The easiest and most effective way to prevent getting sick is to practice good hygiene. This includes hand washing, covering up coughs, cleaning and disinfecting any cuts or scrapes, and not sharing food, drinks, or clothing items. Washing raw foods like fruits and vegetables can help to eliminate pathogens that might live on the surface of these foods. Remember, pathogens can live in contaminated soil and water, which could come in contact with fresh produce. So it's always a good idea to wash vegetables and fruits before cooking or eating. It is also important to ensure meat is fully cooked in order to kill any potential pathogens which could cause foodborne illnesses. Using insect repellents and wearing long pants and long-sleeved shirts in outdoor areas can help to prevent diseases transmitted through the bites of infected insects, like mosquitoes and ticks. Additionally, removing areas of standing water or high grass around homes and in yards can reduce the number of these insects, helping to prevent disease. Finally, getting vaccinated is a proven way to prevent infection and keeps us as healthy as possible. Vaccinations train our immune system, so when we do come in contact with the pathogen, our body is prepared to fight it off. Getting all recommended vaccines and staying up to date with boosters will keep you healthy.